There is no confirmed case yet of the Wuhan coronavirus in the Philippines. And to reduce the risk of the virus spreading, Filipinos have been advised to avoid unnecessary travel to China for now. We have live via Skype from Taiwan, Ross Feingold. He's the business development director of SafePro Group Consultancy to talk about travel safety and risk mitigation amid this new outbreak. Ross, welcome back to ANC.
Good afternoon.
So thank you for joining us. We know that Taiwan has been locked out of the advisory meetings with the World Health Organization because of China's objections. How has this affected detection and response of Taiwanese authorities to the new coronavirus?
Well, like other places around Asia, Taiwan, of course, had experience with the SARS outbreak in 2003. So the authorities here, including at the senior levels of government, some of whom were in government at the time of SARS, including several important politicians in Taiwan who are actually medical doctors, they do have experience with this. So even if there's difficulty in participating in the World Health Organization mechanisms, they have good domestic capability. And of course, they also talk with other governments around the region, even if they're not able to talk to China directly because of tensions in the bilateral relationship. Taiwan is still able to have a fairly productive conversation with the United States, Japan, Singapore, even the Philippines about these kinds of issues. So I think the public here in Taiwan can have a high degree of confidence in the authorities' ability to respond, but they're bumping up against the same issue that other governments around Asia are confronting, which is the rapid spread of the virus and the rapid increase in the number of suspected or confirmed cases, which makes it difficult for any government or medical system to respond quickly.
Right. What about access to resources such as testing kits, medical professionals and consultants, and treatment procedures? Would you say this has been sufficient and up to par with how the rest of the world has been tackling the Wuhan coronavirus in terms of travel, safety, and risk mitigation?
Taiwan specifically, again, they're fairly well resourced. Very interestingly, a few days ago, the government actually banned the export of N95 face masks to ensure that there's adequate supply. That may have been more of a PR exercise than actually something that was necessary. But again, it's meant to demonstrate to the public that government officials are taking necessary steps to ensure that there's adequate resources. So Taiwan is probably one of the more advanced medical systems in East or Southeast Asia. So as far as resources, it's probably sufficient, but again, it has to confront the facts or the reality of the rapid spread of the virus. And the international airports in Taiwan, whether in the one in northern Taiwan near Taipei or in southern Taiwan in Kaohsiung, like other airports around the region that function as transit hubs, whether it's in Tokyo or Seoul, Singapore, Manila, there's a lot of passengers passing through every day who are coming from multiple locations. They're connecting through to onward destinations. And again, this makes it difficult to control the outbreak of the virus.
Right. So what protective measures have you seen at airports, for example, or what pronouncements have you seen from the Taiwanese authorities that you feel have been sufficient or even more strict than usual in making sure that the virus isn't spread in Taiwan?
Temperature checks, again, as with other airports, banning over a week ago, banning flights to Wuhan, both inbound or outbound, before the lockdown. So similar steps that other transportation hubs around the region are taking. Earlier in 2019, Taiwan implemented very strict measures, for example, on carrying in pork products with the African swine flu virus. So very stringent checks were implemented at the airport. So they have a recent experience with this kind of activity. But again, whether they could do it fast enough to contain the spread because of the extraordinary number of travelers who go back and forth. And also keep in mind some other important things here, which is that lots of Taiwanese work in China. They return to Taiwan for the Lunar New Year holiday over the preceding 5, 10, even 14, 15 days. And the incubation period for the virus as of now is estimated at about 14 days. So many travelers would have returned to Taiwan or to the Philippines or Singapore or other locations from China without showing any symptoms. So when they passed through airports, they weren't showing any symptoms. So temperature checks were not really effective. And that's where governments, whether in Taiwan or other places, again, have a very significant challenge, which is telling the public that if you exhibit symptoms, don't be foolish. Go see a doctor right away. You know, quarantine yourself. Self-impose a quarantine if necessary, and take appropriate measures so that you don't become someone who spreads this very easily contagious disease to other people. And I think Taiwan and other governments in Asia are, and in fact now we see even in the United States or Europe or Australia, that's going to be a big challenge, is making sure that people self-quarantine, immediately go seek medical attention, and don't spread the disease even after they've returned to their home country.
Right. We're even seeing reports that a Taiwanese man was being fined for not reporting any viral symptoms. Meanwhile, China is said to have been forthcoming with how its scientists and medical and health authorities have been sharing information about the new virus, unlike how it had been in previous viral contagion. What is the likelihood now that China would give in to the request of Taiwanese President Tsai Ing-wen to share all info about the virus to Taiwan?
That's pretty unlikely. It's more likely that Taiwan will need to cooperate closely with other governments such as the United States or Japan, Singapore, Philippines. The state of relations between China and Taiwan are so bad right now that it's very difficult to have any kind of government to government discussion. But there's always the possibility that this kind of communication could occur, where medical personnel from Taiwan could travel to China unofficially, so using the name of their hospital or university affiliation. That might be a possibility where there could be some level of cooperation, but on an official government-to-government level, very, very difficult.
Right. Amid this health crisis, there have been renewed calls to include Taiwan to be among the members of the WHO. A U.S. senator is said to have also asked the WHO to do so. Would that have any weight? Do the independence and autonomy of Taiwan bear discussing at this point, considering the urgency of the situation?
Well, this is such an important issue for China, Taiwan's participation or preventing Taiwan's participation in international organizations, that even this kind of crisis, a medical crisis or any kind of humanitarian crisis, is really unlikely to change the Chinese position on these issues. It gives them a lot of leverage over the government of Taiwan. And frankly, up to now, most governments around the world, although they'll issue statements saying we hope Taiwan can participate, they don't really substantively take any action to confront China on this particular issue. Then it's unlikely that China would see any reason to change its position on this.
Finally, Ross, are you satisfied with the steps being taken by governments around the world to contain the virus?
Well, again, they sometimes suffer from being a bit behind the breaking news. So you know, they implement temperature checks, and we could say, well, that should have been done quicker. They banned flights from Wuhan, and you say, well, maybe they should have banned flights from additional regions in China. And now eventually we're seeing more of that, or the example of the Philippines, where the tour group has been sent back home. So sometimes the measures do seem a bit slow. Again, in several countries in Asia, they also had to deal with the fact that it was over the holiday. This is the holiday weekend in a lot of places. So a lot of personnel were thinking about taking a holiday, government officials. And that's going to slow down the response as well. So there's always going to be a lot of criticisms. And I think we're going to find a number of things, such as implementation of temporary checks couldn't have been as thorough. Public service announcements could be more thorough. There's always going to be people who break quarantine. And then it's the issue of what kind of punishments should be imposed on them. And even though there's some talk that China is being more forthright, the example that we've been discussing where China doesn't really communicate with Taiwan, I think we're going to see a lot of criticism as well, where people are going to say that China is not being sufficiently forthright. And one more thing is there's been some criticism, and I think we'll see more of it, of the World Health Organization, which over the past week has kind of taken a public response of, well, everything seems to be under control for now. It's not a travel emergency. And they seem to be really stuck with just following their standard operating procedure, which as a large bureaucracy means they move rather slowly. And that leaves governments around the region of Asia or further away to make their own decisions, and the World Health Organization seems to be following rather than being a leader. And there's going to be some criticism of that as well.
Right. Very quickly, as you pointed out, that movement and access are only slowly being restricted, particularly in China. What kind of financial impact do you think that the virus might leave on countries with confirmed cases?
Well, certainly tourism will suffer. Some places were already suffering, Hong Kong being an obvious example, with inbound arrivals down so substantially due to the ongoing social unrest. But tourism sector will be impacted around the region without a doubt, and the impact will be more significant the longer this crisis goes on. So if we, again, we use SARS as an example in 2003, it's a crisis that went on for several months. And a lot of estimates say that for many countries in Asia, it had a 1% or more impact on GDP growth. And in a period when there's a lot of concern about GDP growth for 2020 due to the ongoing trade disputes with the United States and China and some other factors as well, 1% on GDP, if this crisis goes on, is really going to be very significant in Asia. And that's going to force a lot of governments to look at what kind of measures they could take. So some kind of stimulus measures, aid to impacted industries. I think we'll see a lot of that around the region if this crisis continues.
A lot of useful insight there. Thank you so much for sharing them with us. Ross Feingold, Business Development Director of SafePro Group Consultancy. Again, thank you for joining us today.